Okay. Hi, hello everyone. I'm Michalis Kamburelis and welcome to the webinar about the Castle Game Engine and View3dScene XVD browser. First of all, sorry that I'm not giving this webinar leave. I'm a bit on vacation and my internet is crazy. So I'm just recording this video and it will be played for you at the time of the webinar. I will try to join later at the Q&A session, but I honestly can't promise it. So yeah, so sorry for not doing this live, but I hope that this recorded presentation will be all right with you. So let's start. Yeah, so I'm Michalis Kamburelis, I think I already said that, and I'm the author of Castle Game Engine and View3dScene. So Castle Game Engine is a general cross-platform game engine for 3D and 2D games, and we support many graphic formats, and in particular we treat X3D as kind of a special format because the game engine is like, it's a core of our game engine. And so that's a Castle Game Engine, and View3dScene is actually just an XVD browser that is using our engine, and it showcases, well, a lot of features of our engine, and it can be used as a standalone XVD browser to view XVD, GLTF, Collada, or a number of other modern formats. Yeah, but in particular, our support for XVD and VRML is quite, well, strong because, well I focused on this support. Okay, so let's start. One thing I should mention at the beginning is that if you want to remember one link from this presentation, please remember this one link. It's https://castleengine.io/b.php. I'm sure it will be somewhere in the description. Basically, I made this link to redirect to the larger draft of my presentation, and it will contain the links to everything I talked about here. So everything I talk about here is open source, it's free, and it's available publicly on the internet. So yeah, the links to everything that I'm talking about will be on this webpage, and you're most welcome to check it out after the webinar. Yes, please do. And yeah, okay, so let's start. The short plan about View3dScene first, then about the game engine underneath, then about some cool features that we have, then I will talk about other cool features that we have, and then I will talk about how you can roll your own XVD browser using our engine, because I think it's kind of important, it's kind of cool feature that I can offer. Okay, so let's start about View3dScene. So it starts as a simple, normal XVD browser that you just download from the web page. We have version for Windows, Linux, and macOS too. And yeah, you just run it as any other browser. I will run it as in a developer mode, but don't worry about it. It's a normal application. You just double click on it and you press open, and you can open any XVD file you want, any XVD or GLTF or other file you want. Let me open something, random, and just to see that it works, okay. We support various navigation models as expected from any XVD browser. We have Examine, we have Fly, Walk, they work with collisions. I will show them a bit later. We support animations, of course, in XVD. We also have some cool animation panel that you can use to run various animation in your model, which correspond to various time sensor node in XVD. And yeah, you can make screenshots, and you have also like a lot of features here to customize how does the model get displayed on the screen. I will showcase them a little bit later. Yeah, but my first point of what I wanted to tell is that it's just a normal XVD browser. It's a normal application. You run it on your Linux, Windows, macOS, and you just open XVD model and play with it. So that's it. One other thing that I wanted to mention is that we actually have a mobile version of it. It's in progress. I mean, the APK is available on GitHub. I'm running it now as a desktop application, but the point here is that it works on Android and iOS, and we want to release it later this year. So there will be like View3dScene mobile version for Android and iOS. And another thing, and of course it supports everything that Castle Game Engine and View3dScene support, so it supports XVD, VRML, GLTF, and all the features that I'm going to talk about today, they are supported in this mobile version. And another thing I wanted to mention is that we also plan to make a web version, which is will be using JavaScript and WebGL, and it will be rendering the same content. Our engine is written using the modern Object Pascal language, and we have a compiler that basically can take this language and transpile it actually to the JavaScript that allows to run this on the in the web browser. So yeah, so we're going to do that, and we're going to have without any plugins, you will be able to run Castle Game Engine inside your www browser. And yeah, so those are the plans. But for now, the main usage of View3dScene is just a desktop desktop viewer for 3D models. Okay, what I wanted to tell more. Yeah, so there's a web page of it, it's castle.engine.io. Here you can download the engine. You can also go to the View3dScene, and here you can download this particular viewer. Okay, so I'll show the features of the View3dScene in a few minutes. First, I wanted to also show you what does it actually mean that I'm talking that it's based on a game engine. Well, what does it mean? That actually we have an editor, we have a game engine underneath that has an editor, and yeah, it's using this View3dScene extensively. So let me just run it. It's here, and let me just create a new project, all right? And actually one of our templates for a new project is a 3D model viewer. So yeah, you can easily roll on your own model viewer this way. Let me create a new directory. This is a live demo. I mean, I tested it earlier, much earlier, but yeah, I'm really creating a new project now, and just to show you that it works. So you can edit, for example, the user interface here. You can drag here things around like this. You can add new buttons. You can code what those new buttons would do. I'm not doing anything sensible, right? I'm just showing you that it's an actual application that you can customize in any way you like. And yeah, and the point here is that, yeah, so where is the View3dScene used? Well, this sample project actually has includes as a sample, it includes inside its data some 3D models, so you can explore them. Like, here's the car, and I can click on car X3D, and yes, and this little preview, well, it's actually an X3D browser in itself. And we also have a night model here. If I click it here, let me move it. If I click it here, then again, yeah, this is like a small X3D browser inside our engine. And actually I can also double click it, and then as you expect, it just runs View3dScene and allows you to play around with this model. Okay, so it's like View3dScene is a model viewer for our engine, and it's kind of integrated because this is our engine, and the preview is actually another version of this model viewer, and this main view is also another version of this viewer. So it's all kind of integrated and using the same code to render 3D models. I think play a little bit more with this editor, game engine editor later. Okay. So now let's jump. Let's talk a bit about the graphic features that View3dScene and Castle Game Engine can offer you, because I think that the graphic features are kind of our strongest point. I mean, the focus of this viewer and of the is to provide a good rendering for the game engine. So we support animations, collisions, many graphic features, as I said. But for example, we don't support JavaScript scripting inside your model. It's not our focus, because honestly, we have a whole game engine API in Object Pascal that you can use to manipulate those models. So what does it mean is that this is probably a browser for you if you are interested in showing some cool graphic effects, animations, collisions, and so on. If you want to make a program around it, then okay, that this is also something that the Castle Game Engine is something for you, because this allows you to take the model and operate on it in various ways. But View3dScene by itself, well, it doesn't provide really any scripting options. So you're supposed to use Castle Game Engine if you want to manipulate this object in some interesting ways. And you can do a lot of things with it. Okay, so let's jump into the features that actually I want to show. So the graphic features of View3dScene and Castle Game Engine. So, it starts with the fact that we support shaders, and this means that we support standard XVD shaders using Composed Shader Node, and we have actually some very cool extensions called compositing shaders, which allow you to write shading language code that enhances the existing browser shading methods. I will just jump quickly into the documentation just to show you that it is there, and then I will of course show you some demo how does it actually work. Okay, so this is a large description of how it works, and it's a reference with reference and everything. So you're very much welcome to use it. And now let me actually show you that it works. So I'll do this, and let's open some demos with shaders. Okay, I think for example this is one simple demo. Okay, so it's a teapot and it uses the Composed Shader node from XVD to have an animated animated colors on the teapots, just to show that it works. I won't show you the source code for everything that I'm doing, but I guess I'll show you the source code for this thing because it's quite simple, right? So this is the Composed Shader node, and this basically tells you that okay, we're using two GLSL, two snippets of code in OpenGL shading language, and they are very simple, and actually they could be even simpler. I will show you another if we would use the Composed Shader extension. And okay, so what did I want to show next? For example, you can use the Composed Shader extensions to animate the texture. The vertex height based on the texture. So let's do this. Texture noise animated. Okay, it looks like this. So these are the actual vertex heights that are animated based on a sequence of textures. And yeah, this is just a cool effect that you can implement using our compositing shader extensions. So the nice thing here is that it kind of works together with the standard browser lighting and everything. So you write a short snippet in OpenGL shading language that basically says modify the height of the vertexes. And that's all you're doing. The rest of the rendering, for example, how is the lighting applied, how is the diffuse texture applied, well, that's being taken care of automatically by the existing browser rendering mechanism. So if you like writing shader code, well, I think this is something cool for you, because you can write shader code that produces a specific effect, and you can combine it with the existing browser rendering easy. Okay, I wanted to show two more slightly impressive demos. So in the compositing shaders, for example, we have something called volumetric fog. I will first disable the volumetric fog. Okay, and it looks like this. It's a normal, actually it's a static scene that doesn't display. Well, it displays some environment, okay? And now the point here is that this scene, well, it relies on some browser rendering features. For example, there's bump mapping here. If you look at the level, I will have another demonstration shortly about the bump mapping and normal maps in Custom Game Engine, so you will see what it is. But well, the point here is that the browser here, it has some built-in rendering effects that it is using. And I wanted to show that you can implement volumetric fog, which is like in sauna, right? Where it's the place where it's very hot and there's a smoke and fog coming out from the floor and going upward. So I wanted to show that you can kind of implement this volumetric fog, and you can apply this volumetric fog on top of the standard browser rendering, and it works. I'm just pressing the shift and this effect is activated, okay? So this is how it looks like. If it's not visible cool on the recorded video, I can make it a little bit darker. Maybe that's better. Maybe I can make it more darker. Okay, and you should now see how the fog is moving along the walls, and it should be volumetric fog. There are various parameters that you could tweak to make it even better looking. But the point here is that this fog rendering it cooperates together with the standard rendering of how the bump mapping works inside the browser. Okay, what more did I wanted to show? Yeah, I wanted to show something cool with water, because this is, I actually have two more demos with water, because water is cool. I mean, water looks cool. Okay, so yeah, so this is a simple demo with water that shows. Okay, so it's a simple demo of water that shows, well, actually it shows a few things. So first of all, as you can see, there are reflections here. So as I'm looking around here at the water, well, the water shows the realistic, generated in real time reflections of the environment, right? So you can see this building in the middle of the, that I'm looking at here right now, you can see the reflection of this building in the water. Right, and it really works. I mean, it's geometrically correct reflection, and it's also affected by waves. Right, so this reflection is not like a perfect reflection, because it's not a perfect mirror. It's a water surface, so you have waves, and yeah, so the reflection is kind of, well, interesting. It's mostly visible, for example, from this perspective. And yeah, and underneath you can go, and you have even some sort of caustics that are cast on the, that are being cast on the floor. Okay. Yeah. So this is a short demo about how you can do that. You can do water implementing using a lot of shader effects in our engine. And yeah, so let's move on. So this is one thing. Shaders and shader effects that you can compose. Okay, so another cool thing, actually two cool things that we have are shadows. Two cool things because actually we have two algorithms for implementing shadows. We have shadow maps and we have shadow volumes. And yeah, they both work cool, and I'm going to show you how they work. So let's start with, oh, and by the way, as I said, everything that I'm showing, like all the demo models with the water and everything that I'm showing to you, are also open source, are also available on the internet, and you will be able to open them yourself on your own computer and play with them yourself. So I emphasize it because, well, I think it's important. Okay, so let's open one demo with shadows. Okay, it looks like this, and those trees and those columns, they cast shadows using shadow maps. Well, what does it mean that they cast shadows using shadow maps? It means that those shadows are not baked into texture or anything. Instead, you can manipulate the light source at runtime, and it will behave correctly. So, and I actually can show it because we have something, a small light editor in our browser. It's available, as you saw, in the menu, edit lights editor. And yeah, and now you can manipulate the light location. And as you can see, it just works. I mean, the light location, we have actually even a small gizmo that should visualize. Oh, there it is. We have a small gizmo that visualizes the current light position. And yeah, you can manipulate this light to make it cast. Well, as you can see, this works correctly. I mean, the light shadows are consistent with the light reflections on the scene, and the shadows cast by those trees are realistic. And I have some few more demos that show more or less the same thing, but just to prove that it works really. For example, here we have a model that shows shadow maps from multiple light sources. And again, you can play around with it. For example, I'm going to change location of this light. And as you can see, yeah, the shadow changes when the light location changes. And actually, this model shows a few light sources using shadow maps. And they are combined in a proper, realistic way. And you can tweak here the parameters of shadow maps and a lot of stuff to make it even better, I hope so. Okay, so what more do I have? Okay, I think I have actually one more demo with shadows and with castles. Yeah, it's an engine that is called Castle Game Engine. So I have a lot of demos that show some castles, I guess. But the main point of this demo is that, as you can see, the shadows cast by those leaves, well, they work. That's because those leaves on this tree, yeah, They are using textures with the alpha channel. I mean, they are transparent, opaque in some points, transparent in other points. And this is using the alpha testing approach. And the alpha testing works correctly with shadow maps, which means that those leaves, they actually cast correct shadows on the wall. Yeah. Okay, so that's, I think that's about shadow maps. So it supports multiple light sources, it supports it, and it cooperates nicely with alpha channel inside the texture. Yeah, so that's one way to make shadows, and it's all available, as you see. I'm just using View3dScene right now. I talked so much about the Castle Game Engine, but I'm just showing you View3dScene. So it's a standard XVD browser that just you can use and open your own models with the, those. You can apply those effects on your own models and show them in View3dScene. Okay, what model do I have? So we have another approach for shadows, which is called Shadow Volumes. And it's best, it has some, well, advantages and disadvantages compared to shadow maps. First thing that you will see is that, okay, the shadows produced by it are sharp. So, and, well, that's sometimes a good thing. That's sometimes exactly what you want. The second thing, as you can see here, is that, yeah, as just as with shadow maps, shadow volumes are a real-time shadow algorithm, which means that you can modify the light source location and the objects that are shadow receivers or shadow casters at runtime, and it works smoothly. It has some stutter here because I'm recording the video, but at runtime it really likes. Run it yourself, it works smoothly. And yeah, so that's one demo of shadow volumes. I have also another demo, I guess, which looks like this, which is like a simple view of a model that, well, you are supposed to work on this model, right? Like this. As I mentioned, we have collisions, we have, you can walk with standard game control, A, W, S, D, and mouse look. Yes, so if you just want to have like a game-like way of walking along a model, along a level, then yeah, we have this like working out of the box in View3dScene. And yeah, but the point here is that I actually wanted to show how the shadows work. So let me zoom a bit out. Yeah, because okay, you can see that the shadows work. Yeah, that's nothing. You already know that they will work. But one thing cool is now I can actually move stuff. Let me put myself in a bed. So for example, I can drag this shape and I can move it. And as you can see, it behaves correctly, corresponding with respect to lighting. I mean, with respect to shadows. The shadows are correctly cast depending on where this object lies. And also I can modify the position of the light sources. For example, this is the one light source. And okay, this doesn't cast shadows, but it just casts, well, it just makes the things more lit, more bright. And to make the shadow volumes are cast only by one specific lighting, and I can move this lighting too. And as you can see, the shadows move correctly when I'm moving this light source. So you could be, so for example, this scene has some skybox that suggests that this is a sunset. There's sun here somewhere, I'm sure. And the point here is that, well, you could actually make an animation that this light source is like a setting. And the shadows are longer as the light source is moving. Okay. So this is about shadow volumes. So yeah, we have support for shadows, and I think it's cool in our engine. We also support mirrors. I'm going to just quickly show it. One way we support mirrors is by having a cube environment mapping, which means that if you look at this teapot, yeah, I'm moving stuff around, and this teapot acts as a mirror, and it really reflects the objects well, correctly as I'm moving them. It also reflects their shadows correctly. And yeah, those are mirrors working correctly using cube map approach. And we also have our simpler approach to water, which means that water and mirrors, sorry, so planar mirrors, and it looks like this. Yeah, so this is a correct real-time mirror that is here used to simulate water, so I also applied some waves. But the point here is that this mirror is really easy to use using XVD nodes in your own model. So this is all achieved using XVD nodes with some of Castle Game Engine extensions, and yeah, you can use those effects in your own models. Okay, so that's about mirrors. We have also something called screen effects. I think I'm going to only quickly show it, because I think my time will run out pretty soon. So we have something called screen effects, and this basically means that we apply screen effects on top of the existing scene. So for example, I can make the scene some weirdly bent on something like that. I don't think I have time to show a proper demo of it, but for example in games this allows to create some very cool effects like chromatic aberration or blur, where something happens, like you have this game Escape from the Universe, when if you shoot something or if you get some power up, then you have some cool screen effect that shows it. I don't think I have time to show it right now, so I'm just going to continue and you can check it out yourself. It looks very cool. So those effects are really cool way to implement effects in your own games, and they are really cool to code yourself. That's kind of the point here. So we have a documentation of it, and I can just find very quickly this page. This is a page about screen effects, what you can achieve with them, and it's really easy. It's just a screen effect X3D node, and you have an example how to use it. It has an API, and it's really easy to use it to write your own screen effects that perform some crazy operations on the colors displayed on the screen. Okay, moving on. As you may know, I was helping with in the XVD version 4 implement some specify some new nodes that allow to get us a physical based rendering in XVD, and including normal physical based rendering, normal maps, unlit. Hello. And yeah, so let me just show you quickly how does it work. Hello, sorry for the background, but Jagoda is having fun. What did I want to talk about? I wanted to show something about normal maps. Okay, normal maps are always cool. So let's open some demos that show how do the bump mapping works. Okay, this works like this. Without bump mapping, well, if we wouldn't have bump mapping, then it would look like this. Okay, so this looks flat, and with bump mapping, when you have dynamic lighting, instead it looks like this. So you can see how the light source, the light source is affected by a small fractures inside the surface, okay? So this is the point of the bump mapping. I have a few more demos here that show how does this look like. Okay, let me open this, yeah. I'm opening models, as you will notice, in various extensions, like in XVD, custom anime frames, GLTF, and all those things are actually using XVD nodes for rendering. And I will actually talk about it later in 2 minutes, I think, so you will see that, that's true. Yeah, so the point here of bump mapping is that, let me just hide this. So the point, let me run some animation. So the real point of the bump mapping is that those small fractures inside the surface are also affected by lighting. So when I'm doing this, when I'm moving the lighting, it correctly shows the small fractures, small features of the surface of this weird animated lizard man model. So this is about normal maps. I have some more demos. Another cool thing that you can do using the normal maps is that you can, for example, implement something called steep parallax bump mapping. And this is again just something, using standard View3dScene features. So you can use those features yourself using just XVD models. It's all documented. And if you try to move the light here, one thing you will notice is that it also should start casting shadows if I turn on the steep parallax with self-shadowing extension. Okay, so I'm moving the light source now, and those things, like those columns and this lion head, they start to cast shadows. And why is that cool? It's cool because it's actually, there's no geometry here. I mean, it looks like this if you look at the wireframe. So this wall that you have seen is just, it's a quad. it's two triangles, really nothing more. So it's a really efficient way to make cool looking shadows. Of course, they don't look perfect if you look close enough. There are artifacts, but yeah, from some distance, I think they look cool. Okay, what more did I wanted to show? Yeah, so GLTF and physical based rendering, of course. I actually show some. I will actually open some GLTF models to showcase it. And this is one GLTF model, damaged helmet. And as you can see, well, the point of the physical based rendering is that instead of diffuse specular, you have parameters that talk about base color, which is like a natural color that you think about, and the metallic roughness. So the point of the physical based rendering is to simulate materials that you will commonly encounter in real life, to simulate those materials in a physically correct way, or at least in a better way than the standard Phong lighting model. And as you can see, well, it kind of works. I mean, the light source, for example, here, it's just a headlight here, but still it makes some cool reflections along the model. When I'm rotating along the model, you can see that the lights casts reflections in an interesting way on the model. Okay, so that's actually one demo. Let me just open another demo, also using GLTF, and let me just and it also works nicely. Okay, as you can see that this skin, this is leather, this leather thing on this old-fashioned helmet, it looks realistically, right? And this is the thanks to the bump mapping and all the other cool parameters that allow that you can specify using the physical based rendering. So we support it, and we support it when you load the GLTF model. We can also use it in XVD. I was working on putting in the XVD 4 specification the new material nodes that allow you to express physical material in XVD 4. Yeah, so you can use those material features in XVD 4, and they are in specification of XVD 4. The draft of which was released a few days ago. Great. And you can use those features already in View3dScene. So that's something I wanted to emphasize, I guess. And yeah, we also support something called the unlit material node. Let me just show it quickly. So this is like a full dimensional game, the Unholy Society, that we have been making with as part of Catastrophe Games Studio, and it's using Castle Game Engine. Let me just turn off the music really quickly once I have the option to do so. Okay, so let's do it like this. And yeah, so the point of it is that you can, well, this is the game using Spine format underneath, and actually it's everything you see is XVD, because we import a Spine model format and we convert it to XVD nodes. And so everything you see is actually rendered using XVD. And for example, let me load, this model, and I will just briefly show it. Okay, so this is an XVD model. This is an animation done in Spine, displayed using Castle Game Engine, and it's using our Unlit material nodes for pretty much everything, because this is like a comic style of a game. And yeah, so this is just a short demo of Unlit materials, that they work and they allow you to create some cool game effects that I think look nicely. Okay, let me just close it, and I guess we should wrap it up because I'm running out of time. So those were the Unlit material nodes. One other thing I wanted to mention is that we support gamma correction. By default, we support gamma correction when you have the physical material, because this seemed like the best compromise between backward compatibility and, well, having a good features. Gamma correction is a good way to display lighting correctly, but you can tweak it. You can say that the gamma correction should be applied always, or also on Phong lighting model and so on. Or you can turn off the gamma correction completely if you'd like to. So yeah, so we support gamma correction, and it's really flexible. That was the gist of what I'm saying. Our View3dScene allows you to run various animations. You have seen it already. You can walk around the model with collisions. You have already seen the demo of it. You can also open any kind of model format in View3dScene. You already saw it. And I also said that, okay, this means that actually every model format is converted underneath to a number of XVD nodes. So let me now just prove it really quickly. So let's open, for example, this damaged helmet, okay? This is a GLTF model. Let it open. And what I'm going to do now, and you can now use to show you that you can use View3dScene to convert between from various model formats into VRML or XVD. And yeah, it's really easy. I mean, you just use the file save as VRML XVD menu item and you save it. And yeah, and let me just show you that it works. So I just saved the GLTF model. I save it into an XVD file, okay? And now I'm going to just open it in a text editor just to show you that it really works. Okay, so this is this file. It was generated by a tool, remember? So it, well, it doesn't look nicely. But yeah, it's correct XVD model. And for example, you have here something called base texture. And you can, for example, modify this node. For example, you can say that the base color instead of default yellow, white should be yellow. Or I can, for example, remove the emissive texture and yeah, let's see, and remove the occlusion texture too, because why not, just to see that something happens, okay? And now I can open this model, and if I wouldn't modify here anything in this XVD file, then my model, my XVD model would look exactly the same as the GLTF model. But since I modified the material parameters, well, now I have the damaged helmet that is a bit yellowish. It's actually a bit greenish because my yellow color was multiplied component-wise, I guess, with the mostly greenish, not red, with the green and blue texture. So yeah, but the point here is that it works. I mean, you can take GLTF model, convert it to a number of XVD nodes, using just file save as, you can save it as an XVD file, and then you can edit it in any text editor you'd like. And yeah, so that's I think that's a cool feature that we have. You can also use inline to kind of compose, put one model format like GLTF inside XVD. I have a demo for it. I think I'm definitely running out of time, so I won't show it, but the point here is that you can have a large XVD model, and inside this XVD model you can take parts for other model formats. Like, you can take this GLTF part, you can take something from the wavefront OBJ part, from STL part, and yeah, it all works. Okay, so that's what I wanted to mention. You can also create screenshots, and you can convert models in batch mode. You can even actually install it on your own server and create a web service out of it. I actually made this web service to convert between various model formats, but you're basically free to use it as in batch mode, and I think this opens a lot of possibilities. And the last thing I wanted to talk about, as well as something that I actually already mentioned earlier, is that you can very easily make your own model viewer using Castle Game Engine. You can treat XVD as a kind of a black box, so you can compose various scenes inside your model, or you can also build. You can modify and or build the XVD graph. So you can add nodes, you can modify nodes. And let me just show you a very quick demo of it, and then And then we'll finish, okay? So this is the example, the simplest example of a model viewer generated by our engine. And I've already tweaked it, right? I have added some stupid button here. So let me just run it, okay? Just to show you that it works. I just run it pressing the F9, compile and run. And let's wait a bit. First time we compile the project, it takes a few seconds. The second compilation, of course, is extremely fast. I'm using Object Pascal, as I mentioned earlier. It's a modern language. It has objects, generics, interfaces. It has also fast compilation, and it's also native, which means that your code runs fast. Kind of out of the box fast. It's kind of on a C++ level, if you like to compare languages, which means that you have manual memory management, but you have also type safety. I mean, actually you have better than C++, I think. Anyway, in Object Pascal, you have a nice type safety, and the syntax, I think, looks nice. And yeah, it's a fast language, it's a modern language. That's the gist of what I'm saying, but it is true. There are references on my webpage about using this language. So for example, if you know C# or Java, then I think you can really quickly like look at how does it look in Pascal class helpers or static classes, static class methods and so on. Everything is generics, everything is described there. So if you come from other programming languages, especially object-oriented programming languages, then I'm sure that you will find Object Pascal like very good. And this is like the extremely simple example that we have, application that we have just created. So it's a very slightly modified version of the model viewer generated using our engine. The buttons work. This is actually the GLTF model. This is actually the X3D model. You can also load custom model, I mean, from anywhere on your disk, of course. You don't have to load only things inside the data. The buttons work because I coded them to work. This is a new button that I added 30 minutes ago, so it doesn't work yet. But of course, it's easy to make, to use code to actually make it work. So now about this approach of using scenes. So one thing, one way to use this engine is to treat the scene as a kind of a black box. So you can create another scene. I just duplicated the scene name, and you can add a name for it. So like scene another, and you can open here, let's open anything really. This was in Collada. I didn't show Collada today, right? But we support Collada too. So I just opened the Collada model. Sorry. And let's just... okay, and it's... and it's too large, I'm sorry. let's delete it actually then. Let's do this, let's bring it back, let's add another scene. Sorry, I prepared a different demo in my head, but what I wanted to show here is that you can open, for example, this animation, all right, skinned animation demo from GLTF. Okay, so I have just added another scene to my lever. And of course I can, scale it. I can translate it. The graphical gizmos like to perform this, scaling will be of course available. We actually are working on them. For now, I'm just doing it by hand, and of course I can also translate it and like this. Okay, so it's kind of nonsense thing that I did, but the point here is that I was able to easily place two scenes from actually two different two GLTF scenes, but it would work equally the same if they were one X3D, one GLTF, and I can use those scenes, and I can write Object Pascal code to manipulate them in any way I like. I mean, I can run animations of them, I can manipulate X3D nodes, for example, I can change the material node, I can completely rebuild those scenes if I would like to. So I can also make procedural generation where I'm creating the X3D nodes by code. And actually, let me show you this just as a code example. So I'm going here, then I'm going here. We have lots of examples how to do it, but let me just show you a code how to do it. So basically you have an Object Pascal API that you can use, for example, to create an X3D material node, and then you can place it inside the appearance, and then you can create X3D box node, create it in an X3D shape node, and so on and so on. Now, if you know X3D, now you said probably something like, aha, okay, so this is how I can use my knowledge about X3D and connect it to Castle Game Engine. And yeah, all the X3D nodes are exposed in a natural way as an Object Pascal classes. All the X3D fields and events are exposed as properties or callbacks inside Object Pascal, and you can use them. And yeah, so if you know X3D nodes, then like you can modify, you can build them in any way you like using Castle Game Engine. And I think that's everything I wanted to tell, to talk about. Very sorry for being, I think I used much more time than I wanted to, so very sorry for taking much longer time than I wanted to. And yeah, and next up, I wanted to announce the next speaker, which is the Doc Sanden. He's amazing. he's the main developer. He's doing a lot of stuff. He's working on free WRL, and it is the most complete XVD browser on the available just, and he implements the free WRL implements really pretty much complete VRML and XVD specification, all the nodes, all the components. Then don't make a fuss like me, like, okay, I'm focusing on graphic and I'm not focusing on this. No, FreeWRL really implements everything. So if you're looking for a complete VRML and or XVD browser, then FreeWRL is really great choice, because it works great. It's also cross-platform, also Windows, Linux, and it's open source, of course, as the name free would suggest. So next up is Doc Sanden, and thank you very much for listening. Okay, bye bye.